The Philippines has eased lockdown measures in some areas in a bid to revive the economy. But is the country ready for business? And where are we in the COVID-19 pandemic response? To answer these and more is Dean Ronald Mendoza of the Ateneo School of Government. Dean Mendoza, thank you so much for joining the program.
My pleasure, Rica.
Dean, now last year's fourth quarter budget deficit skyrocketed slightly, pushing this year's full year deficit higher than target. Now with the pandemic greatly draining government coffers and tax revenues also hampered, the question now is the country now entering recession?
That's a good question. I think that's the concern of many of us, certainly economists and also folks in the private sector. The technical definition of recession is the way it's often used is two straight quarters of economic contraction. And we had the first quarter already revealed that it did contract. That contraction in the first quarter of 2020 ended really an 84-quarter growth streak for the country that stretched as far back as 1999. So that's unfortunate for us, and we hope that this quarter, the one essentially linked to the ECQ, is not going to be as bad. But we are expecting some really sobering figures.
Mm-hmm. Dean, taking into consideration what happened in the first quarter of this year, plus the impact of the pandemic, what do you think are new policies the government can craft to cushion the impact of COVID-19?
Well, there are a number of things that our government has already implemented, including immediate social safety nets, social protection programs. They are calling part of this the social amelioration program. These are critical because part of our response to contain contagion, which includes social distancing, quarantines, restrictions on mobility, essentially the lockdown, these are things that actually harm our economy precisely because they prevent the kind of economic activity that will expand the pie. Mm-hmm. It will actually contract. So we need to put in place buffers, cushions, in order for our people to be able to adjust. The other part, of course, is the credit and liquidity provided to the private sector. But as you have been reporting, this is not necessarily going to be enough. So the way to think about the lockdown is it's buying us time to strengthen our health system, to strengthen our social protection system. But we should not squander that period. We should come out of the lockdown soon and stronger so that the recovery will be on stable grounds under a strong social protection system and a strong health system.
Dean, you mentioned lockdowns in some areas. There are some areas still in the country that will remain in stricter lockdowns than most. But when we continue doing this, of course, the effect on the economy is going to be great. What do you think are things we can do for us to be able to recuperate, especially on areas with lockdowns still being implemented?
Well, first of all, we should have a clear strategy on when the lockdown will be lifted and clear metrics that will guide us, even as the lockdown is lifted, on whether that lockdown is a part of a stable recovery or do we need to go back to restrictions as far as the lockdown is concerned. So there is now a growing debate as far as the data on cases. There is a concern that we are not testing enough. And so therefore, one of the triggers, one of the bases for deciding may not necessarily be sufficient in the amount of information it's providing. So this needs to be corrected very soon. The other part that we need to do is, since we have locked down essentially the area in the country with the biggest growth engine for the entire country, which is really Luzon, we should find a way to actually augment that economic activity while Luzon is actually in lockdown. But we should also have a strategy on how to begin to lift the lockdown and apply a recovery process that is much more nuanced. The lockdown essentially is something I would call an axe. But what we need right now is a scalpel, something that is much more nuanced. We don't necessarily lock down entire regions. We lock down areas with high risk and then manage the recovery in areas where we now have a little confidence that there are not so many cases there, and so we begin to resuscitate economic activity there.
Mm-hmm. Dean, there is such a thing as lockdown fatigue, and you mentioned that the scalpel and axe mode that you said earlier, and that a lockdown is essentially an axe, and people with fatigue, with lockdown fatigue, mostly need to go out. It would be going against everything that the government is trying to protect. With this, fighting the lockdown fatigue and also needing to follow what the government is asking from the people, how can we balance everything?
Well, we can balance this with better information, better data, and better communications, quite frankly, to our people so that they are not confused. Mm-hmm. And then a strong public-private partnership that works with some of our corporations, many of our SMEs, so that we all work together to make mm-hmm. sure the recovery is a safe one, mm-hmm. we don't have a relapse, and we are able to also hit the target of resuscitating our economy. Right mm-hmm. now, there seems to be a trust deficit. Mm-hmm. So we don't trust the data that we have. We think that it's actually insufficient. Mm-hmm. And then we don't necessarily trust that the lifting of the lockdown is actually made with the right information. So the timing issue is still a concern. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, we have our colleagues in the private sector who are saying that the lockdown was never meant to be forever. It was actually just supposed to buy us time. Mm-hmm. And we are essentially creating the next big crisis that the country will face. Mm-hmm. And the first one is COVID-19, but the second one, which could actually be quite as deadly as well, mm-hmm. is an economic slowdown or is an economic recession mm-hmm. that could also create socioeconomic costs.
Mm-hmm. Finally, Dean, before I let you go, the Philippines is among the countries hardest hit by COVID-19 in Asia. What do you think are things we can learn from our regional peers on how they address the pandemic?
Well, I think the number one lesson, which is immediately useful for the recovery phase, the lifting of the lockdown, is that we need inclusive and strong health systems and social protection systems. This starts to build the trust between the people and their government. And this is actually what will alleviate many of the concerns of citizens who feel that they need to go out to actually earn a living because they earn a living on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. If we actually had a strong social protection system with information on our citizens that is properly managed and their privacy is protected and they have trust in the system, mm-hmm. then I think we would have much more nuanced, much more agile responses. Mm-hmm. And by the way, the psychology of the recovery, which I believe you mentioned in your report, mm-hmm. this is very, very important. Even if you lift the lockdown, but citizens and private firms do not believe our systems in health mm-hmm. or our systems in social protection are sufficient, mm-hmm. then they will still not engage in economic activity, in consumption, and in investments. They're going to wait and see. So mm-hmm. the recovery will be a very, very weak one and not necessarily as strong as what we would like. So mm-hmm. that, I think, is the main lesson from South Korea, Taiwan, mm-hmm. Singapore, many of the countries that succeeded: a strong health system and an inclusive health system, mm-hmm. plus a strong social protection system and an inclusive one.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you so much for your insights, Dean Ronald Mendoza of the Ateneo School of Government.